Good morning, everyone. So today we have with us Professor Barbara Plank. She's a full professor at the IT University of Copenhagen. She's part of the NLP research group at the university and an analyst, the NLP scholar. She's co-chair of the European NLP Summit and was elected ACL Publicity Director. And she was awarded several prizes, such as the Amazon Research Award, Outstanding Area Share, and this year she has an Outstanding Paper Award at the ACL. And her research interests lie in domain adaptation, transfer learning, continual learning, and semi-supervised machine learning applied to cross-domain and cross-language NLP, multimodal learning. And so today we have the pleasure of having her give a talk here at the Summer School. Thank you for coming.
Yeah, thanks a lot for the invitation. It's really, really a pleasure for me to be here as, you know, a former LXMLS participant some years ago. So thanks a lot for, you know, this honor to give a talk here today. All right, so welcome everyone on this Saturday. I hope you had really a great summer school so far, I'm pretty sure. And today I'm gonna go to like introduce you to the broader picture of transfer learning with a particular focus on multitask learning. And to start off with, I will give you an overview of what are like the challenges that we're trying to address with these methods. So I see you know, one of the big goals of NLP is ultimately to have language processing technology for everyone, right? So we would like to go way beyond the languages that we are supporting today, because there's so many out there that we have very little support as of now. So there's one dimension of this picture, but also we would like to, you know, have technology that works well across different types of text domains, or what also called text genres sometimes. And the third dimension to this is that we would like to have, you know, a lot of NLP tasks that are supported in order to enable NLP for everyone in the long run. Now, if you look at NLP today, we are still, you know, a lot of the core technology is based on learning from labeled data, essentially. And so if you look at, you know, it's essentially learning from some input to some output. And this can be of many different kinds. Of you all know, like it can be labels, it can be structures, it can be relations, you name it. But one thing in common is that typically it's very, you know, time consuming to get to these labels. And it's also expensive, and it, you know, a lot of quality control goes into this also to come up with very good data sets. Now, in fact, if you think about NLP in general, there is, you know, all of the data that's possibly out there, which is written, is huge, right? But if you think about our labeled data sets that we're working with, they are like a tiny dot in this whole universe with what we're working on. So I call this the problem of wide sparsity, right? We don't have enough labeled data, essentially. At the same time, we also, you know, even if you have unlabeled data, say, for some cases, even this unlabeled data can be very sparse. And an example here with is, for instance, if you look at the languages that, for instance, multilingual BERT or XMLMR are trained on, we do see that, you know, for like English, there is gigabytes of or terabytes of data. Like this is on a log scale, but if you go to low resource languages, then there is very, very little even unlabeled data out there. So even X can be scarce. And I will come back to this in one of the case studies that I'm gonna present you later on. Now, so we can see this, in fact, as this, you know, long tail of languages that we are ultimately interested in. And we are very good at covering the head, so to say, but there's a lot to be done on what's called resource poor or low resource or underrepresented languages. A second aspect is though that, so we have a scarcity on data for the languages, but there's also a scarcity of text domains. So this here shows you a picture that, you know, a table that plots the languages in UD some time ago, this was 2016, so 1.3, versus the type of text domains or genres that were captured in the UD data set back then. And what we notice is that this matrix is very scarce again, right? So we're seeing actually a bias towards a certain text type, and that's newswire. And if you look now more recently, so this is a plot by my PhD student Max, who's also here at the LXMLN now, we do see that, you know, over the last 5 years, this has, you know, of course, there are more languages and more text genres that we can find in this data set, but still we are, you know, the bias remains. So we are still facing a lot of newswire or nonfiction text in, say universal dependency data. But, you know, these are essentially two dimensions to this bias problem. So you can think of this as two dimensions of input shifts, like this cross-domain or cross-language shift. And essentially, they all have to do with a very common assumption that in machine learning, we assume that we have IID samples, right? That the distribution you're training on is similar to the distribution you're testing on. But in the real world, this is often not the case. And so this is where transfer learning comes in and tries to address this problem. I would also like to point out there's a second issue that is related to data bias, and that can be the output dimension, the label dimension. So often in NLP, we are essentially labeling data, and we aim at a single ground truth label. And so we are essentially aggregating the different annotations from the annotators in order to come to one interpretation. But it has been shown that this is actually some idealization, and I will go into this aspect in the third part of my talk in the case study to show that there is actually more if we also look at these disagreements and embrace them in learning. You might say, okay, these are all very valid problems, but could we just, you know, what about a simple solution? We just annotate more data, right? And yeah, of course, that's great. And we need more data, we need more resources. But you know, if you think about this, even just this two-dimensional problem for a specific task, then this is a huge space, right? So we will essentially never be able to cover the full matrix. It's very, very expensive. At the same time, I want to highlight that, you know, this is a simplification because these are now boxes, right? Which are with kind of, this matrix suggests that there are hard boundaries between languages and domains, but this is actually not the case. And in fact, you know, what is even this domain? We can think of it as some underlying, like we can think of our data sets of in lying in a high dimensional space, but we don't know all the underlying factors that go into this space. So we can think of language as a factor or a dimension, but we can also think of genre as a dimension, or even these genre and topic apart as two dimensions. But we can think of our data sets as, you know, in this high dimensional space with unknown factors, and our samples are essentially the dots in the space. And some of those will be more typical than others, right? If you think, for instance, at Twitter, is Twitter a domain? But still, you can think about how this kind of text type looks like, right? So we can think of it like prototypes, even in the notion of Wittgenstein. Right, but this is like a little bit of a philosophical take on the whole. Let me go now into the bigger picture on what are core methods that we can use, what can we do about it? So typically in machine learning or NLP, we are in fact training and evaluating a model on say one domain, one task, one language, and then we start from scratch when we go to the next problem, say problem B. But can we do better? And yeah, the answer is yeah, that's where adaptation transfer learning comes into play. So the main core idea is to exploit knowledge that we have gained by training model A or using data from task A in order to transfer that to another problem. So from typically what's called from a source to a certain target case. Now, in fact, we can plug in the different problems. For instance, we might be interested in a cross-domain gap or cross-domain learning. And say now we have newswire data and we are interested in essentially trying to build say a parser for Twitter data. Similarly, we can see it as a cross-lingual problem where we say want to transfer from like a high resource language like English or German, or even there can be multiple sources here, to a certain target language like Danish in this case. Another solution is use multitask learning, where essentially we are exploiting multiple tasks at the source site in order to solve typically a specific target task that we are interested in, or multiple tasks at the same time. And finally, we can also look at, you know, data that's essentially like fortuitous data out there, which is not necessarily labeled for the task at hand, or is a byproduct of labeling, and that we can also use as a sign, as a kind of signal in order to bridge this gap. I will come at a later stage, come to this point back, so make this point a little bit clearer. But before going there, I will show you essentially three views of transfer learning and trying to categorize this big space. So for the next part, I will also assume that we have essentially a set of, you know, we have a feature space X, and our data, or in this case, data domain, we have a marginal distribution over this feature space, and X is typically our input features. At the same time, we have a task, which is, you know, we have a label space, what are the labels we're interested in, and we're trying to build a classifier that comes off of a categorization of the Ys given these Xs, the feature space we have defined. And X, Y is a certain label space. All right, so one view of transfer learning is essentially this picture by adapted from Pan et al. And Struder et al., where we split it up by, okay, are we actually transferring between the same tasks? So we have a transductive transfer, or are we trying to transfer from different tasks? And so in the transductive case, we can think about this as different domains and cross-domain learning, or we can think about it as different languages and we face the problem of cross-lingual learning. Instead, in inductive transfer, we are interested in learning from different tasks. And then we can think of, okay, if we have all the tasks and all the data available at the same time, then we can do multitask learning. And I will go much more in detail into that path afterwards. Or we can think about sequential transfer, where tasks are not here at the same time, but they are coming in one at a time. So sequential transfer is one of the big things that we are doing today. But also there's much more in, say, continual learning, where you're really interested in learning a sequence of tasks while not forgetting about the previously learned tasks. So you want to ideally learn incrementally multiple tasks. Right, so another view of transfer learning, instead of by the tasks, is by the inputs. So we can think of transfer learning as addressing this problem of data mismatch. And so if we have, say, the X's that change, we have input shifts, right? Sometimes, for instance, the marginal distributions might change, and that's the problem of, say, domain adaptation. So you have similar features, right? But they occur in different proportions, and even together with the labels, they might change, right? So this is when we are facing a domain adaptation problem. To the like extreme case, when the inputs completely change or almost completely change, we might say the vocabulary changes, then we are facing cross-lingual learning problem. Now, if the data mismatch is more in the Ys, then we can think about, okay, we are trying to learn a different task, then we can think about multitask learning, or again, sequential transfer or continual learning cases. And here I would like to mention that, you know, sequential transfer is something which is really omnipresent today, and we'll describe it after the next slide, what this exactly means. But it's one of the many types of transfer learning that we have. So the third view on transfer learning is, okay, what are the resources that we have available? And here we can think of, okay, if we are interested in transferring to a certain target task, do we have some labeled data at our disposal? And then this typically nowadays is called few-shot learning, so that we have a few examples that we can use for adaptation, right? And if you look at few-shot learning, then we can think of two ways, like few-shot fine-tuning, where there's a lot of work on this now, or we can also see few-shot learning without parameter updating when we do something called like in-context learning, like GDP3 has been proposing, or the whole work now on prompting. notice that for all of these categories that I'm drawing here, they are not hard boundaries, right? So if you see the literature, there is also like in context learning, it's also, you know, introduced as zero-shot learning, where you essentially do not update parameters. So it's a bit of a, you know, where do you exactly place it? I place it here because I see it as some sort of still instances, these prompts that you're giving, right? You do not update, but still there are like instances that you learn from, in contrast to zero-shot learning, where you do not have any sort of target information, so any target data. And so in fact, if you do not have any labeled data, then the typical thing is zero-shot learning. And then you can think of, okay, either just transferring the model as such, as a baseline, or you can try to think of ways to overcome this problem of lack of data. And here again, we can use multitask learning, or there's a huge additional literature on additional methods out there that can be exploited. I will come back to this at the very last slide to just give an outlook, but just a note here that this is a huge space as well. All right, then just to mention this one point that I had made previously, you know, sequential transfer is really like the omnipresent transfer learning paradigm today. And with that, what I mean, it's essentially the large pre-training and fine-tuning paradigm. So it's right, it's sequential. You have unlabeled data, you train your big language model, and then you do adaptation on some fine-tuning on some target task. And what I've noticed in the over the last years is essentially that people nowadays refer to transfer learning largely as this setup. And this is really true. It's now become the standard. But it's more like the standard that you can also fit into this much bigger space of transfer learning, right? There's many, many more techniques and problems out there than just the fine tuning by itself. All right, and the problem still remains then in this, and this is a lot of active research right now, in sequential transfer learning, how do we actually adapt, right? And one way that it's very common is to do full fine tuning on, say, the few shot samples or on the full task that you're interested in and so on. But there is also work by, for instance, what you have heard late yesterday by Irina and Jonas on adapters. And this is a very active area of research that is more efficient, right, than updating the full model. All right, so in the rest of the talk, so I hopefully have given you like a bigger picture now of transfer learning. And in the rest of the talk, I will essentially focus on three selected case studies. But before going there, I want to highlight multitask learning and go into the details of multitask learning, which is one way of doing transfer learning. I would like to say, actually, you can interrupt me anytime if you have pressing questions. So please feel free to do so. And yeah, there is one actually. There is MAML, exactly. MAML is like the meta learning initiative. And that would be one of the few shot learning cases, right? So actually you could see this as an extension of multitask learning. So I would put it under that umbrella, which then also falls under the, you know, it falls under multitask learning extension, but actually goes to the future learning. So it's not exactly easy to plot it, but that's the idea. All right, then thanks a lot. And let's look at multitask learning. Multitask learning essentially is a big area. And the main idea is, okay, typically you have single tasks, right? You are interested in, say, doing a task A. And then when you have a new problem, you are starting from scratch, you're learning task B. Now, can we do better than that? That's the main core idea. Instead of starting from scratch each time, can we leverage information, transfer information? And here is an example that, you know, puts this into a bit of a broader dimension. So imagine, you know, it's a nice summer and you want to learn how to ride a motorbike. And this is kind of your main task, but you also know how to learn, you know how to drive a car. So you can think of this as like an illustration of multitask learning. So you want to learn a certain main task by exploiting information from your previous, you know, from your how to drive a car. And but notice there are similarities between the tasks, but there are also differences, right? How to change gears or how to brake is different in the two cases. But this is like a motivation of what is multitask learning roughly. So in general, in multitask learning, we are interested in generalization, and we want to, you know, share parameters because that helps us to generalize better. So we typically learn in multitask learning, learn tasks in parallel at the same time. So we typically have one main task which we are interested in, and auxiliary task or multiple auxiliary tasks that we are adding. And notice that sometimes the task might be equally important, but a lot of the literature is actually focusing on improving on a specific task, but it really depends on the setup. And there's a very nice paper by Rick Caruana from 1997 that introduces this main idea in a very nice way. And in neural networks, there is, it's actually very, you know, they are very well suited for multitask learning because we have representations that we can then share between the tasks. And then we essentially can add additional decoders. For each of the auxiliary tasks, we can add additional decoders and hence have additional loss function that we are interested in optimizing. Notice that it really depends on where we are sharing. So this is a huge area, you're right. We are sharing either the whole model or only parts of the model. This really depends on the exact setup. But this is the main idea, adding these decoders with additional loss functions. Yeah, there's a question about how to balance. I will get back to that at the very much, much, much later. I will show you a case on when balancing might be important. But let me formalize this problem a little bit more. So we are having a set of T tasks with their corresponding data sets. And the main goal then of multitask learning is to essentially train a model jointly over all of these tasks, where we have multiple loss functions, one for each of the tasks. And we might in fact even have also a weighting term for each of these tasks in place. Right, so we are interested in optimizing this joint loss. And as illustration, so you imagine now you have these two sets of data. You have your network. You're using now standard sharing everything architecture with separate decoders at the end. And then the simple recipe is essentially that you are selecting a next task, you're taking a random training sample or batch of that training sample, and then you update the loss in your from your network in order to train this network, and then iterate this procedure. So essentially looking at all of the data while you essentially recognize or remember where does this instance come from which task, in case you have separate data sets, right? But I will get back to this later on. So, but now the problem is, or the question is, why multitask learning? Let's look a little bit more into the motivation of this. So first, there is a scientific interest, right? So we humans are, for instance, very good at solving related problems, or also for general language learning. We are very good at learning languages in parallel. But there is also a practical problem or practical view. So multitask learning leads to simpler models that we can learn one big model essentially instead of several single task models. And often they generalize better, or they are even more efficient in learning. So let's look a little bit at this two aspect: generalizes better and is more efficient in learning. Now, why would MTL help in generalizing? Intuitively, one intuition is it helps you to focus the attention of the net on certain features in a way which are important for both tasks. So you can think of this as, imagine you're going to, you know, pick mushrooms and you have this basket, which is of a certain capacity, right? And you're interested in finding the good mushrooms, right? So similarly, in the net, you have multiple tasks that you need to learn. And by reducing the capacity, since now you have to learn multiple tasks with one model, you essentially can get better generalization. Now, another aspect is representation bias, right? Each task typically lives in, has optimal parameters in a certain parameter space. And one motivation is also that multitask learning helps to find the space which works well for both tasks, for instance, or drags the solution more to a joint space where there's low error for both tasks. Another intuition is sometimes, you know, you might have auxiliary tasks which look at predicting some parts of the input even. And that helps to you know, predicting a little bit of the future, what's coming next. For instance, if you think about doing language modeling at the same time in NLP, it's similar of trying to predict the next frame in vision, and that can also help to generalize. Overall, it is a regularizer. So you can think of it like learning two tasks conjointly is helping you to not, you know, learn very high weights for certain tasks. So you can see multitask learning also as a regularization effect. And that's particularly helpful for small data sets where you might easily overfit with a complex model. Now, this is generalization. Now, what about efficiency? Here you can think of, okay, one motivation by Rick Carana is, you know, eavesdropping. What do we mean here? Imagine you have a task, you have a feature, say G, which is very difficult to learn through a task A, but by learning task B, it's actually helping to learn this feature because it's easier to learn via B. So in a way, you can eavesdrop on the other task to help you solve the problem for task A, for instance. This is eavesdropping. Another thing is that it leads often to better convergence. So now this is a paper by Colbert and Weston in 2008. This is one of the actually very pioneer work on multitask learning in NLP. What you see here is semantic role labeling. The plot, the dark plot is the single task model and the error rate over epochs. And you see that the model learns much quicker by adding these auxiliary tasks to the model. Another motivation is for efficiency is that it can help you to replace traditional pipelines. And here I have an example where we looked at, for instance, a biomedical event extraction, where you're interested in, okay, given triggers, you want to find the arguments for these triggers. So you want to find these biomedical events. And the typical approach was to do it in a pipeline in two ways. So the first step is to identify these triggers. And the second is then to identify the event structure, right? And we have recently proposed a joint model that works with multitask learning in order to predict both tasks at the same time. And the key idea was to use multitask learning and a linearization of the main problem. And with linearization here, I mean that we are actually, you know, treating the structure prediction task as a labeling problem where we try to predict the distance to the next entity and so on. This is what we call BESEL or biomedical event extraction sequence labeling. And what we found here is essentially that it's working very, very well. Outperforms previous approaches, which were based on pipelines mostly, but it is also much more efficient in, for instance, here is in the inference time when we compare BESEL to the best model for which there was source code available and the number of sentences processed per minute. So it can be very efficient in, you know, deploying a single model. And finally, in fact, you might think of multitask learning also in helping you to reduce the need of labeled data. Imagine now you have this task here, you have a task here from a certain domain and language, but you don't have any labeled data for much more labeled data. So you might think of, hey, I have a related task in a similar domain and we are actually exploiting this by multitask learning to help us learn better this space. All right, so finally, just, you know, to wrap up, a couple of perspectives on multitask learning. You can think of this really as a way of exploiting diverse data sets or distinct sources. So by training on different data sets, like from other languages, but these data sets can be also really further away, like Also from human data, can, you know, if you have keystrokes or gaze data that has been shown, that you can leverage that also for improving NLP models. I noticed that you really learn from distinct sources, right? They don't need to be annotated with the same labels, the same data with multiple labels, so to say. But of course, there's also, you can see it also as learning from different views, right? Where we have some auxiliary task, which is another layer or even derived from the data, right? There's also, you know, you can derive data from the original data. Or you can think of it like syntactic layers that you are doing, like POS and then dependency and so on, as multiple layers from which you can learn a joint model. And finally, you can also think of it like, okay, selectively sharing certain information, that you're doing certain tasks only at certain layers. And this has been shown much earlier. And similarly, also now in the probing literature, we see that BERT is storing certain information better in different layers of the transform architecture, for instance. So is then multitask learning something new? No, multitask learning is actually something pretty, you know, pretty long time. It dates back to early machine learning. And in fact, here is one of the early applications of multitask learning. This is Elvin. It's one of the first self-driving cars, not exactly the first, because that's, as far as I know, one by Ernst Dickmann in 1986. But Elvin is interesting because they use multitask learning in order to improve the steering, so to say. And what they did, they added auxiliary tasks, which were, you know, where is the road? What is the intensity of the road surface? Where is the location of the center lines? They added all of these task-derived auxiliary tasks in order to help the model learn better. And so this is an example of, okay, they have a steering direction, but then they added this auxiliary task to learn not only the main task, but also these auxiliary tasks. You can see this is, okay, the network now needs to focus the attention not only on the main task, but also at on the other tasks. In NLP, there has been, as you all know, right, 2015 was like the main core turning point, I would say, as also Chris Manning called it, the tsunami of deep learning hit NLP conferences. And since then, we are really, really focusing a lot on neural network and deep learning approaches. But what came with this is really like this, what we call the multitask learning wave, because then it became very intuitive to exploit this kind of method for multiple NLP tasks. And in fact, you can think of this as, okay, early work in this early deep learning times focused a lot on LSTM and CNN-based approaches. But now, since we have transformers, we can actually, you know, it's not that MTL has gone, it's actually omnipresent, I would say. So MTL is really everywhere. And why that? Because, yeah, if you think of, for instance, BERT itself, it's a huge multitask cloner, right? So it has also multiple objectives, the mask language modeling, and the next sentence prediction. So we can, what we are actually doing is multitask pre-training nowadays. In fact, this is also very similar that this multitask DNN proposed by Liu et al. In 2019, they do a BERT model where they pre-train on multiple tasks and then fine-tune on the single task in the end to get the best performance back then on Glue. So this has become now, you know, multitask learning today is largely a BERT-based or type of BERT-based models with multiple tasks at the output layer. All right, so this is the introduction, and in the rest, I will go over three examples, concrete example studies that we have been carried out. And we'll actually come back to the questions at the end if this is okay now, okay? But just go ahead and ask questions in the chat also at the end. All right, now let me go to the first problem, cross-domain learning. So in this work, we were interested essentially in, okay, we have, you know, imagine we are doing multi-source domain adaptation, and that means we have a certain target domain at our disposal, and then we have a set of source domains. The question is, how do we best use these source domains, right? And the main idea here is that we Now, imagine we neglect these domain labels. And in this case, we also notice we also have label table at our disposal, right? So imagine you are also doing like parsing and you want to parse a low resource language, but which of the whole huge UD data is the best to use? So this is now a similar problem in the space. And the idea is we want to learn how to select the best training instances from multiple sources using data metrics. The motivation is, why is this actually interesting? Why don't we just train on all source data, right? That's a very, very good question, in fact. And the problem or the thing we want to overcome here is prevent negative transfer. So, you know, often, for instance, in sentiment analysis, if you have a feature that's predictable, that's not a very good, you know, feature for book. But for, say, electronics, it's very good if it's a predictable electronic device, right? So we have these features which do not transfer well to other domains. And prior approach in data selection has, in fact, used only single metrics in isolation and focused on a single task. So here we wanted to essentially look at multiple tasks, and we wanted to use multiple ways of how to characterize similarity and learned on a policy over that. And our intuition here is that different tasks and domain require different notions of similarity. So we wanted to have a look at this, whether we can also transfer these similarity weights across tasks and so on. So the approach essentially boils down to, imagine now you put all of your source domains into a big bucket, and you want to learn a policy that reweights the examples or sorts the examples so that you're taking a smaller set of M examples from the whole pool and you're training a model on those mostly highly related examples. Now there's what we proposed in this is Bayesian optimization. And the main idea is, okay, now here you have a set of features that you use to characterize your instances or similarity or even diversity of the instances. And we are learning a weight over all of these feature similarity and diversity scores. How do we do this? In this framework, we do need, essentially, we are running, we are training the model on iteratively and look at the small dev set in order to come up with a good set of weights in order to select the best data. Now the question is, what are the features that we are using? And this, in this case, are really similarity functions like, okay, you know, you have tome distributions and you might just do a Jensen-Shannon over these two tome distributions from source and target in order to see how close they are, right? And so you can think of different ways in order to represent your instances like just words or distributions, topics or word embeddings in order to come up with different similarity functions. And similarly, what we proposed here is also you can look at how diverse are the instances that you're adding, how many types are in there, and so on. We did this for three tasks, sentiment analysis and post-tagging and dependency parsing. And we did, you know, for sentiment, we have four target domains. And in each case, we take one as the target and the other ones as the source domains. And for response tagging, and we start from use wire and we try to port to the other sample domains in this case. What is a baseline? Right, baseline is using just a single metric. And so we used one of the earlier works that proposed, in fact, Jensen-Shannon on dome distribution in order to find the closest instances to the target. Or we can actually also say, okay, we are keeping the domain labels, right? And then looking first at what's the closest domain and select from that space in order to select data for the target. And this is what you see here. So I'm jumping to the results. Now this is sentiment. We select 2000 examples and compare these two ways of selecting either the examples or the domain, the closest domain in order to transfer. We compare it to a random selection. And what we can see is in the sentiment case, in three out of the four cases, it was the most beneficial baseline to look at the Jensen-Shannon divergence over the domain. So select the closest domain and examples from there, then selecting from the whole pool of data. kind of improve this with the approach that where we learn a weight over this. And we saw, in fact, that we can improve upon this by learning this similarity metric, the weights. But we also saw that effectively for sentiment, it was beneficial to not just have the similarity metrics, but also the joint with the diversity metrics was very helpful. But then you can also think of, okay, what about training on all of the data? And in fact, in the sentiment example, we see that we have a clear drop and a negative transfer. So just training on all of the other source data sets was not as beneficial as selecting more targeted data. We did similar results for parsing and post-tagging. Here we'll just show you the dependency parsing results. And what we see here is, interestingly, for the baseline, the best was to not keep the domain boundaries, but just select the best closest examples. So this is different from the sentiment case where the domain selection was better than the simple example selection. We also see some improvements over with the weighting compared to the same metric in this case. But we also see when we train on all of the data, then that was the most beneficial. But notice this is really a lot of data in this case. So it's almost, you know, almost a magnitude more. And it's quite expensive to get this data in the first place. But we saw that here, you know, domains and tasks can have different notions of similarity, and learning this policy helps. But we also saw that the simple single metric was actually quite beneficial already, right? This can avoid negative transfer. And we have also results in the paper where we try to transfer these weights across tasks and domains and models, because you can think of, you know, I learn it for one model and want to transfer it to another, or I learn it for one setup and want to transfer it to another in order to not need to do this all the time. Okay, then just a small note. In fact, this experiment shows to some degree that, you know, these domains are not so clear cut, right? In sentiment, it was much more clear that these domains were helpful as the original labels, but for the parsing experiments, it was a little bit more fuzzy, right? And there has been also recent work on, for instance, finding data which is closer to the task, which has been shown to be more beneficial. So a lot of these data selection ideas are still very, very relevant today, also in like BERT times. And here are a couple of pointers that I to give you a couple of the references in this direction. All right, let me just see if we have some example question from this here. Right, this is all about the multitask learning, which I will get back to in the end. Then let's look at another example. So now we looked at cross-domain learning. What about cross-lingual learning? And here's a recent study with Rob van der Groot, Ibrahim, Aizan, Ahmed, and many more from the lab and collaborators, in which we were interested in, okay, if you think about, you know, this big, you know, the voice assistant that we can find nowadays, here is a map of the languages in Europe, and I've just plotted on what are the main languages that are supported by these devices today. What this plot shows us is, in fact, that there is still a lot to be done, right? Even within Europe, and that's just a small snapshot of all the languages out there. So we were interested in this task of slot and intent detection, which is one of the core understanding tasks in this framework or in this space. And so you have here an example of, okay, I would like to see showtimes for a silly movie at the movie house. And the main idea is, one task is to find the intent of the user utterance. And the second is to find what are the slots for that intent. And so how can we then transfer knowledge to the low resource languages? And in overall, if you think about the literature, there are two main approaches. One is by using transfer on the annotations themselves or translation, or what is now very, very common is to do a transfer on the representation space and use multilingual embedding approaches to to transfer. So we are focusing on that, but here compare also to annotation projection in machine translation. So the main idea what we are interested here is taking a typical fine-tuning or sequential transfer setup where we use the multilingual model and then have an adaptation stage. We have only English training data. Where when we started this work, very few data sets available for multiple languages. So we set out, and part of this work is also a new data set that creates an evaluation benchmark for multiple languages. But the main task then that we were interested in is, can we actually improve English training when also adding auxiliary tasks for the target language, so non-English auxiliary tasks. And so what are the tasks we were looking here? Essentially, we looked at three tasks, which are like, you know, related to the kind of availability. So one is just raw data, and we're doing mask language modeling at the same time. One is parallel data, and we are using an auxiliary task that does, you know, translation. And one other is parsing, where we use UD parsing as auxiliary task. Now, the data that we have created is called multilingual latent intent detection, and it covers a total of 13 language variants, including a low-resource dialect. So this covers a broad spectrum of languages from different families, thanks to our collaborators here, and it's available on this URL. The experiments we carried out was essentially a BERT-based model called MATCHAMP that does joint intent and slot prediction, but then we add these auxiliary tasks. We compare that to a strong baseline, which does neural machine translation transfer with attention in order to project the slots. And I will just highlight two results. One is, in fact, overall, over all the languages, what we found is that essentially mask language modeling for slots now was very helpful, but the other tasks weren't that helpful for this task. And for the other, for the intents, it was very, the strong neural machine translation baseline was actually very, very good. But I want to look closer at a little bit at this German dialect, which is included here. So we have in these 13 language variants, we have one that is South Tyrolean, which is a small, you know, it's a small language dialect spoken in northern Italy, shown here. It's an Austro-Bavarian dialect, and it's spoken by roughly 500,000, you know, in a province with roughly 500,000 inhabitants in northern Italy. It's approximately 2/3 are German speaking. There is no common orthographic standard, and it's also a language which is highly influenced by other official languages like Italian or, for instance, Latin. And here we have an example where you see that there is a patent. Patent here means a driver's license, which is much closer to the Italian la patente instead of the German Führerschein. And also the case, the gender changes. So it's quite mixed language. And here are two examples that show you also the non-standard spelling for today, for instance, which can be written in different ways. And I'm highlighting this here because this is a dialect for which it's very difficult to get even unlabeled data. So looked at different sources. There is no Wikipedia, for instance. And we looked at social media sources, and we found a little bit on Twitter, but it's highly mixed with other languages. There's no dialect identifier around. There's one other source, Ask.fm, where people post short question and answers, and that is more dialectal. So we could gather a little bit of data from there. But is this then, this very tiny amount of data, is this actually helpful? So we did the baseline with multilingual BERT, giving us around 49% of one. And if you do now a mask language modeling auxiliary task, we saw a big improvement over the baseline by just 30,000 sentences. So the question remains then, we have different amounts of data from the two sources. And so if you do this 6,500 from Ask.fm, that's very helpful. And the same amount from Twitter is a little bit less helpful. So overall, the closer the type of language is to the target, the better it is. So we can also see this pattern here coming back. So this is, you know, the the second study that I wanted to show, where we introduced this new data set for multilingual evaluation of intent and slot detection, we've shown that the auxiliary mask language modeling is a quite robust auxiliary task. This has also been proposed for domain adaptation in another paper that came out at NACLE, for instance. And we've shown also that for a very low resource dialect, we can actually use unlabeled data to improve results with auxiliary mask language modeling. I would like to highlight also, there is a video by from the NACLE presentation. So here is a link where you also can see many, many of the co-authors of this work. All right, then let me go to the very last part. So there is a study, there's a question on the cross-lingual setup actually. Can we zero-shot tasks in other languages by pre-training multilingual and then adding a task-specific head trained on English data? Yeah, exactly. This is exactly the idea what we did here, right? So we are pre-training, we take a pre-trained large language model and then we add task-specific heads where one is for English and we continue training on the main task. And then the other head is for the language-specific auxiliary task for which we don't have labeled data, but we have these auxiliary labeled sources like mask element. All right. Now, the last part, I'm going to another direction where we also use multitask cloning, but we use it with fortuitous data. And what I mean here is one type of fortuitous data, which means data that is out there, which we can use, is disagreement. So this is work that we did, yeah, some time ago already. The main idea, you know, this is, again, a big area. But the main idea is that often when we do annotation projects, and disagreement between annotators is really, really ubiquitous. We find it everywhere. And there is even, you know, even if you think about more objective, presumably more objective tasks than, say, you know, subjective tasks, but like about the speech tagging, then we can find that there, even there, there's linguistically hard cases where it's not so clear what is really the gold standard. So here is an example about from data sets, say anything with boyfriend, where anything has been tagged by different annotators in different labels. And so what can we do about this? Well, typically we try to homogenize and come up with a single aggregated ground truth, or we can take another route and say, okay, maybe there is no ground truth out there and we can actually look at leveraging this sort of fortuitous data to learn better models. So this is this last part that I want to show you. So the question is, okay, if you look at these human disagreements, are they randomly distributed or can we actually estimate them from small samples? And so in a study, we looked at, these are part of speech tagging results for two sources where we have doubly annotated data. And these are the confusion between annotators. So we see that there are similarities across domains for confusions, for instance, adjective nouns or particle adpositions were very regularly confused. There are also some, say in this case, Twitter-specific confusions, which are more prevalent, but overall there are correlations between these confusions. So how can we exploit this information? We can embrace them in algorithms, or there's also literature which suggests to filter out data use only the agreed on data, but we take here this algorithmic approach and try to see this as a sort of fortuitous data source that we can leverage. And with that, I mean, this is a term that is more broad where, you know, you can think of often data that's out there, which is not necessarily labeled for the task at hand, but it can be harvested to some degree and can be used relatively easily. And so the annotation disagreement is just one type of such data that is not very available, unfortunately, but it's quite relatively usable. And so how do we exploit this disagreement during learning? There is actually a survey coming up by Uma et al, which provides an overview of quite a lot of the approaches proposed in recent years. In early work, we proposed a simple approach where the key idea is, okay, imagine we have a small confusion matrix from, estimated from a small sample. Then we know what are typical confusions between annotators. And now when we learn a model and it makes a mistake, which is equally, you know, which also annotators disagree on, then we propose to tell the model to update less in these cases where annotators disagree on. And this is a kind of cost-sensitive learning with this confusion matrix. Recently, we asked ourselves, okay, can we actually exploit multitask learning for this? And the key idea is imagine now, instead of having just a small set of doubly annotated data, you have much more also for the training data. And in typically, instead of, you know, we make one ground truth out of the multiple annotations, but instead of just training on this ground truth, we want to embrace also this variation of possible interpretations from the annotators. And so in typical setup, we are training a model and observe the gold label and do cross entropy loss on the gold label. And in this approach, we propose to use the annotator distribution as soft labels in multitask learning. So the idea is you're still doing train the model with gold labels, but at the same time, you're essentially also integrating the annotator disagreement distribution by having an auxiliary task which looks at the divergence between the predicted distribution and the annotated distribution. And so if you have these two distributions, there are multiple ways to measure this divergence. And in this work, we found that the KL divergence worked very well. We have the results in the paper for two tasks in this case. And we saw that multitask learning with this auxiliary loss was helpful in both post tagging in this case and stemming. And this is, you know, since then we also applied this to other tasks and we found this to be very useful. This means again that there is not, you know, disagreement is not only nice and we can embrace it during learning. I've shown you two ways to do so, but there's a much bigger literature on that. And but one of the main takeaways is also that we consider releasing your raw annotations instead of just the final annotations, because then we can actually study these disagreements in much more depth. And a related question is also, hey, what about understanding these divergences and how do they impact evaluation? So we also have an upcoming workshop paper at the ACL workshop for evaluation this year. And I'm running out of time, but I want to just, you know, give you a couple of practical points. So going back to multitask learning, and this is actually coming back to quite a few of the questions in the chat. You know, not all that is glitter is gold, right? So there is a problem of interference. And in fact, when you share parameter across tasks, it might actually lead to deterioration of performance. So not all tasks might be equally helpful. And or similarly, if you have a data form, a huge, you know, one data source is very, very large, it might in fact swamp the learning of the other tasks. And there are solutions to this, for instance, by sampling the data or weighting the loss. And I want to just give you one example here. So this is Udify. This is a parser that has been proposed where you learn a single model which does essentially five tasks. So it does all of the dependency. It has a dependency parser, but also auxiliary tasks for lambdaization, features into universal part of speech tagging, all in one go. And this model is great because it can be learned on all of the UD data, right? So you get essentially a single model for all of the languages. Plus it is able to give you all of the UD tasks back, right? But now the question is it good? So the original model was just trained by training on the whole of the UD. And we did recently, so updated a study on looking at different impacts of weightings of the original tree banks. So here you see the distribution of the data from the different languages and you can weight them differently in the training, right? So you can smooth them out by giving them, balancing them more. So for instance, here is 0.5, which is giving more weight to the lower resourced tree banks, which was essentially what worked very well. So here is the result where we train single models for all of the languages in UD2.6. So this is a lot of models. And on average, we get an LAS score of 72. If we train instead a single multitask model on all of the data, just out of the box with no smoothing, then we can improve upon that. But it was more helpful to essentially balance the data by smoothing the distribution here. Then another thing is, but though, you know, what we also often see is multitask learning is particularly helpful in low resource cases. So what we plot here is the results for the low, so where we have less training data. And what you see here is that multitask learning is especially beneficial. So this is the multitask learning over, you know, all of the languages together versus smooth. This is beneficial for low resource languages where it, you know, it's becoming not, it might be better, you might be better off with a single model if you have a lot of training data. In zero shot cases, you might be surprised by this bar plot over here, but what this means is this is again a single model, not a multitask model. And this is selecting the best, or by a simple measure, selecting the matching source data. So you might be better off also in selecting data again or selecting the model to apply on. But this is like a, you need to, you know, either you get a single model that's able to handle a lot of things, or you get a more specific model, right? There is this trade-off to be made. All right. And again, in fact, there is also interference. If the there's a nice paper that recently came out which looked at, again, at the kind of UDFI and all of these UPOS, U features and parsing as a joint model. And what they saw, in fact, is, you know, that in fact, for some languages, it's very easy to learn post-text, but very hard to learn the parsing task. And if you weight them equally, then you might actually get worse performance than when you try to scale the model. So you might be cautious on, you know, improving. So some tasks might overwhelm the overall loss so that you underfit the main task. So this might be important to weigh tasks accordingly. In fact, not all the glitters is gold. Multitask learning does not always work. And it's actually, there is some work on trying to come up with a priori measures on finding what are tasks which are useful. We have done some early work on looking at the label distribution, how uniform that is or how big that is. That gives some clue, but it's not enough. So that you can also look at the learning curve, for instance, or even more at the mutual information between the inputs and outputs, which has been shown to be more informative. But there is much more to be done in that direction as well. And finally, I want to just highlight that if shown you multitask learning with hard labels, so to say, there's also been a proposed work by, instead of learning from, you know, labeled data, also by learning from a knowledge distillation approach. So you have a teacher, and you have, you know, tasks which are coming from knowledge distillation instead of hard labeling. So you train on the gold labels or on a teacher model. And they also introduced knowledge distillation with teacher annealing. So you, over time, you know, in the beginning, you trust the teacher a lot, but over time, you're trusting much more the gold labels that you have at hand for your labels, for your task, which might be much less than these predicted distributions here. Or there's also interest in, you know, back to my picture in the beginning, I plotted multitask learning as one dimension compared to continual learning or sequential transfer. And in fact, you can also think about merging these two ideas, right? What if you have tasks that come in progressively? Can you learn better when you learn incrementally, so to say? There's also work in that direction. And there is also, coming back to Rina's talk, combination of adapters and multitask learning, because so far adapters were essentially for each task you have a separate adapters, but there is also very, very recent work on archive coming out that combines multitask learning with adapters with sharing a hyper network that generates weights over adapter weights essentially. So very interesting directions here. All right, with this, I come to the end. So key takeaways is, you know, there is scarce and biased data everywhere. This is a ubiquitous problem. And transfer learning is a large paradigm, and sequential transfer learning is one kind. It has developed as the main underlying paradigm we are using today. But my point is really that there is a much bigger space of methods and problem in this transfer learning space. And one example that I've given you for how to address that is data selection. But there is also multitask learning, which might help in low resource setups. Given you one example, but in like auxiliary mask language modeling, which is, you know, beneficial, but you can also think of it from learning from very diverse sources or using them as soft labels and so on. But there is this interference problem, which can be an issue. And so it takes a little bit of time sometimes to see whether it actually works. And overall, I've addressed, you know, this problem of learning when there is a lack of labeled data via one way. So we are trying to reduce the need of labeled data via, for instance, this broad transfer learning or fortuitous data sources. But, you know, there is even, if you think about the literature, a huge space on additional methods to generate additional labeled data, pseudo-labeled data. And how you generate that is very, very diverse. There is a whole space of methods again. I've touched up on some of them, like knowledge distillation, briefly mentioned in the end. But you can also think about weak supervision or even active learning, where you actively have the human annotator in the loop, or data augmentation. All of these methods are also in the space of, you know, generating additional labeled data in order to overcome this problem, on which I haven't touched up on here. And with this, you know, I would like, you know, to say there is now a really exciting time to study these problems, and a lot of interest also in this space to address scarce and biased data conditions. I've outlined three sample studies. And with this, I would like to thank you. Here is people from my lab. So quite a few are at LXMLS today. So please get in touch with them. And I hope this has been, you know, given you an overview of what is transfer learning and problems in this space. And I'm now happy to take your questions.
Thank you, Barbara. Since we're very tight on schedule, I would just answer a few of the main questions and maybe post them on the Slack channel so you can answer them with more time. Yep. Thanks. The monitors, if you want, you can ask the questions now.
So should I pick some
let me see. You can pick just like the main ones.
Okay. So I picked the one in the beginning. So what are the dimensions of data shifts that are currently under-researched in your opinion? That's a very nice question. So I think we have a lot on now low resource languages, right? On even written languages. So there is a lot of, in fact, shifts to languages for which there is not really one written form, like dialects is very little, but also, as you say, sociolects, right? It's even adding the demographic dimension into this is very, very under-resourced. So there's a whole space of computational social science, which is living but not so interacting yet with multilingual NLP. So there's certainly much more in this direction at the intersection of these disciplines to gain. I think I have answered some of the task questions in the beginning, in the end. The question which always comes up, how to estimate in advance which task will be useful. This is a very difficult question, and there has been some work. I've tried to point out a couple of studies in this direction, but there's also a little bit of work on trying to predict performance and transferability. It is also an underexplored topic since it's also a very practical problem, actually. So it's both scientifically interesting and practical, but underexplored as well. So we are looking at some of it in this space as well. Would you still classify probing as MTL when most of the times you do actually train representations? Whether probing is multitask learning? I would think that's a little bit different because you're training the probe later on, right? So multitask learning is mostly when you do it in parallel, but you could have certainly multitask probes, right? As well, but yeah, no.
I think most of the questions you already touched them already, but feel free to clarify them on the Slack channel.
Yeah, I see very, very nice questions here. And in fact, the last one I touch up on is why so few research done in languages with different alphabets. That's very interesting and a hard problem in NLP, right, at the moment. And we are only at the beginning, I think. Even variation within languages is maybe my main point. So, you know, I'll end with this point. I outlined the space of languages versus domains, right? But these are not orthogonal to each other. These are dimensions of variation. So we also need more work on cross-domain, cross-lingual cross-domain evaluation, and to also evaluate, you know, within different types of texts in the language or social texts in the extreme case, so that we look more in depth at this also from the evaluation perspective.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Barbara, for the great talk. It was really interesting.
For everyone for attending. And again, thanks for the invitation. Sorry for going a little bit over time here.
No worries. We'll continue on the Slack channel.
Thank you, Barbara.
Bye-bye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye.
See you.